What's up, guys? It's Trek, and I can't believe this one's going up on the main channel, but I'm a man of my word, and usually you guys never see these videos because usually I have a corollary, but this is something that happens once your channel reaches a certain size. Companies, particularly companies from China, will email you and be like, hey, we'd love for you to try out this sample. Please make a video on your YouTube channel. And I usually reply the same way, which is, I have a public PO box. Send me anything that you'd like. If I dig it, I'll make a video. Usually that means that the litany of weird beauty products and fidget spinners that show up here don't wind up making it onto video because most of the time they're just not that exciting. They're just not like that compelling or unique in any sort of way. This one is just interesting enough to make the cut, so I want to make a quick video for you because I have actually been using it. I do actually enjoy it, and so I feel like I owe Geetech, which I believe I'm pronouncing correctly, a video, a thank you for sending this over. So this is a review model of the Geetech A10M. This retails for $250, so it's quite the substantial gift, and I am sincerely appreciative. What separates it from other 3D printers? Well, as you guys know, my fleet is mostly Prusa Mark III's and CR10s. And this is basically the combination of those two, dialed way the heck down. So it's dumb like a CR10 and small like a Prusa. It's using Prusa geometry, which is to say that it's a Marlin style printer with a single runner here on a belt, and then its Z is controlled by one stepper over here. And that's about it. That's as simple as this is. It's a very simple, dumbed down, very cheap Prusa that runs more like a CR10 because it's not direct drive, it has Bowden tubes. Now, as opposed to the A10M, which is a $180 to $200 printer, this one has two drives up here that feed filament into the combined nozzle down here. So this nozzle is 1.04 nozzle down here that feeds two separate 1.75 millimeter filament strands from two separate rolls that sit on top of the printer, which is again very similar to what a Prusa looks like, except this is feeding both of them into one heated chamber and then spinning them out. And the thing that this does that honestly most multi-material printers I've ever experienced either don't do or can't do is that it will blend them. And so I've made a couple of these blasters. These are actually both for sale over at foamproshop.com, but the purpose of this video is to talk about this printer. But this just gives you a really good idea of how this fade works, and since it's not done in the code. You load STLs the same way you would onto any printer, and then you set a fade percentage on the hardware itself. And so you can tell it, like, I want you to start orange and fade to black, and orange to black, and then this one's obviously a pure orange magwell, and then orange to black, but wait, there's more, then stop and do orange, but also there was black gunk in the nozzle. So as long as you're willing to kind of master it and play with it, another isomer would be like, what's the difference between this and, say, an Ender 3? Well, a Geetech A10 is just an Ender 3 by another name. They're both very cheap, roughly $200 printers that get the job done. They really only work with PLA. They don't play nice in enclosures, et cetera, and so forth. But this is one of those, essentially, by Geetech with Geetech support that comes with a separate drive for a separate filament and has some sort of unique, I don't even know how to describe it, heated chamber that will feed two separate filaments into it and then extrude them at a consistent rate. Things that I like about it, it's worth suffering through some of the hardware blips and software tricks to get this guy dialed in and tuned into printing even nicely. While it doesn't print nice out of the box like a Prusa, it's worth dialing it in because if you dial it in and get it running right, it's actually quite the cool effect. This fade is awesome. Right now I have a neon green and Prusament Galaxy Black in here, and you can see that the sparkle fade into the neon green is actually quite compelling and quite cool. And again, you can't do that even with some sort of like palette or multi-material unit, to my knowledge. The fact that it's hardware-controlled percentages is really, really cool. Things that I don't like about it, the bed is incredibly cheap. I've damaged the bed in the center, so I'm printing on the corners. I'd like to upgrade the bed, which is cheap and easy because it's essentially just an Ender 3 clone. The other thing that's a little upsetting is this interface is on like a green LCD, a really high latency, I suppose, which is to say that sometimes you click on the wrong thing or sometimes you enter through the menu and it doesn't always give you exactly what you want. So sometimes you'll program in a decent blend and then you won't get that blend. That said, it's so inexpensive I do appreciate them sending the review model over. It is worth talking about. In particular, it's really cool for things like this because you can, instead of having a hard break here with like orange to black, you can fade into that. I think that the safety orange fade like that is quite cool. I think it's very compelling, very novel, very neat. And overall, like, it's not telling you anything that it isn't. It's a very honest machine. It comes out of the box. It sets up very easy. The hardware coding means that it's actually a whole lot easier than doing something like multi-material in Slicer, where you have to like code different things in. Like, it's, I don't want to say it's stupid proof, but the machine is so dumb that if you're relatively inexperienced with 3D printing, you can get nice fades, gradients, etc. without too much troubleshooting or work. And then everything else is the advantage of these cheap printers are that you're working with hardware that has lots of cheap replaceable parts, and if you do end up bricking the entire thing, your investment wasn't ridiculously high for that first lesson. I'm a big believer that like anyone who wants to get into 3D printing needs to make a lot of 3D printing mistakes, because otherwise you're just never gonna understand how these things work, how to troubleshoot them, or how to fix them, and that's honestly the most valuable skill. So this video is droned on and on and on, but if you want a closer look at these, they are on my website, they are for sale, they're Halloween themed for the season, and this kind of lets me do one-off fun fade pieces like that. I'm thinking about doing a hummingbird next with it, but I'm going to upgrade the bed first. But I did just wanna say that like, it's a remarkably inexpensive machine. It's very affordable in terms of not only what you would cost to get into it, but also like how much time it costs to troubleshoot it and get it running. That's it. Huge thank you to G-Tech for sending it over. I'll put their link down in the description box below. I sincerely do appreciate the sample model. I hope that if you guys are looking for a unique effect like this, or if you're just looking to get into a cheap printer, while I could easily recommend the Ender 3 as kind of a Prusa clone that's super stupid proof, I actually would genuinely recommend this one, because you're paying an extra $50 for something that nobody else can do, and that's a good way to make your products unique, that's a good way to make your prototypes stand out, and it's a fun option that truly you don't even have to take advantage of. If you pay $50 and never use it, then oh no, you overpaid for your, you know, budget 3D printer by $50, and then maybe if you burn out the hardware on this, you could just feed from the other one. It's like buying the spare parts to an extruder. I've run this guy for about 250 hours of print time at this point. I've done a few different spamps, a few different prototypes, and ultimately we started running it on production parts when we got it really dialed in for some of the internal bits that aren't super like specific. They don't have to have the most remarkable tolerances, and you can just print those one color, no gradient programmed in, and it'll just feed normally. So that's the printer. It is truly, like, in the spirit of honesty, I wouldn't ever promote to you guys something that I don't use and enjoy myself, and I do use and enjoy it. Is it cheap? Yes. Is it dumb? Yes. Is it absolutely unique and novel? That too. And at a price that nobody, you can't buy a multi-material upgrade. You could buy three of these printers for the cost of a multi-material upgrade, and that is actually pretty cool. So thank you guys so much for watching. If you have any more questions about 3D printing, I did a whole video on 3D printing for the Nerf hobby way back when. I'll link it in the description box below, along with a link to this printer, along with a link to these guys down here. But I appreciate you guys sticking through this one. I know it's not Nerf content, but I actually do like this product. It's just solid.